It's my great pleasure to welcome you today to our panel, Unconventional Wisdom, Presidential Politics in 2016. We developed this panel title in January, before the Iowa caucuses. And at that point, we realized that this race was going to be unexpected. But if you had told us in January that this was going to be essentially a three-person race on the Republican side, and that the Democratic contest would still be underway, I think we would have said that everything that we know, everything we've studied, everything the textbooks say about presidential campaigns and elections would say you're wrong. And that's correct. But this is the year of unconventional wisdom. So to try to unpack what's happening and venture a prediction, if we dare, on what happens next Tuesday, March 15th, in Ohio, Florida, Illinois, and North Carolina. We have three experts talking with us, and two moderators, myself and my colleague, Mr. Larry Levy, who is director of the National Center for Suburban Studies at Hofstra University, and former commentator, political columnist at longtime expert on American politics, particularly elections, at Newsday. Let me just very quickly give special thanks to my colleagues who've helped in organizing this event, Richard Himmelfarb in political science, Rosanna Parati in political science, my wonderful colleagues at the Cultural Center, Athleen Collins, Carol Mallison, Amy Trotta, and of course the Office of University Relations, Carla Schuster and Melissa Connolly, as always. Thank you. As far as we have numerous classes here today, let me just say without going to great detail, but many thanks to Professor Goodman, Professor Corey, Professor Binka, Professor Burnett, Professor Himmelfarb, and Professor Bengals for bringing their students, bringing your students to participate. And thank you all for joining us today. Let me give quick introductions. I think our speakers have been here before. I think we last convened this panel for a discussion of the 2014 midterm elections. That was the spring of 2014, before the Republicans had won control of the Senate. And I think it's fair to say when there was still a hope of policymaking in Washington, one of the questions we're going to talk about today is whether there's a chance of any governance in this election year. To address these topics, we have, and why don't I go from the left, Governor Howard Dean, who is a former Democratic National Committee chairman, U.S. presidential candidate, governor of Vermont, and practicing physician. He is currently a senior strategic advisor and independent consultant for governmental affairs at McKenna, Long & Aldridge, which is an international law firm. He focuses on healthcare and alternative energy and provides expertise based on his extensive time in public service and public office. He's the founder of Democracy for America and serves on the board of the National Democratic Institute, where he focuses on Southeast Europe and China. He's a regular commentator on MSNBC, and he is, of course, a senior presidential fellow at the Kalikow Center at Hofstra. When Governor Dean was chairman of the Democratic National Committee, he created and implemented the 50-state strategy, which was widely credited with helping the Democrats make historic gains in Congress in 2006 and 2008. Mr. Edward Rollins is one of the country's leading political strategists and communications experts. He managed Ronald Reagan's 49-state landslide re-election campaign in 1984 and has had major managerial roles in 9 other presidential campaigns. Mr. Rollins has served in 4 presidential administrations, Richard Nixon, Gerald Ford, Ronald Reagan, and George H.W. Bush, including 2 tours of duty as assistant to the president, the highest staff appointment in the White House. Mr. Rollins, in the Reagan administration, directed the White House Offices of Political Affairs and Intergovernmental Affairs, and was also deputy chief of staff in President Reagan's second term. He was the first non-member of Congress to serve as chairman of the National Republican Congressional Committee. Mr. Rollins is currently a Fox News commentator and was inducted into the American Association of Political Consultants Hall of Fame. And he is also a senior presidential fellow at the Kalikow Center and actually an instructor at Hofstra this semester with Dr. Himmelfarb for our American Presidency course. Mr. Glenn Thrush is Politico's chief political correspondent, senior staff writer. His latest piece, Five Takeaways from the Democratic Debate, yes, that's right, the Democratic Debate last night, was posted at, I think, 12:38 a.m., Glenn, and is very interesting. So he's here fresh from covering the latest, and I'm sure we'll be doing the same for the Republican debate tonight. Glenn Thrush previously served as Politico's main White House correspondent and won the two top awards from the White House Correspondents Association, as well as the Gerald Ford Award for Distinguished Reporting on the Presidency. He published two New York Times best-selling ebooks on the 2012 election and has worked for numerous publications as a reporter and editor, including, just to name a few, Newsday, The New York Observer, Bloomberg News, The Daily News, the Birmingham, Alabama Post-Herald, and City Limits. He is a Brooklyn native, and we're glad to have that he was able to make the trip from the debate to New Long Island to speak with us today. Please join me in welcoming our panelists. I'm going to turn this over to my colleague Larry Levy to ask the first question.
Pay attention, Jeff. I don't know about you guys, but I've been doing this political stuff, journalism, and then academia for 40 years, and I've never seen anything like this. Every experience I've had, every way of analyzing things just seems to have gone out the window. I don't even trust my instincts anymore. So I think, just to get right to it, from your varying perspective, just to explain either or both the Trump or and Sanders phenomena. Why?
Well, I have a little more experience than you have. The 1912 election was the Teddy Roosevelt, William Howard Taft, and it was the last one. You can go back, that's very similar to this one, in which Teddy Roosevelt decided he wanted to come back and be president after having toured Africa for a period of time. His hand-picked protege was in the White House. Teddy Roosevelt went out, won all the primaries, and basically the bosses took over the convention and renominated, and he created the Bull Moose Party and destroyed the Republican Party for the first time since 1860, and we may be on that verge again. And I wish there were political bosses who could take it over and fix it, but there aren't. My sense is, and I'm very honored to be here with this guy, because I've been in the business for 50 years and I haven't got a clue what's happening. And I get up every morning and I read his publication first and foremost to get my talking points for the day. And I can tell you, Political is just this extraordinary publication.
And then you're in real trouble there.
Oh. I said to Charles Krauthammer the other night, he said, Ed, I plagiarize everything that you say on the air. And I said, Charles, I plagiarize everything you write. I guess that's why I think you're so brilliant. But I don't think any of us know what's going on today, except there's a very angry electorate out there. And they don't know what they want either, but they don't want what's here. And that the most staggering statistics I saw in the Michigan primary the other day, where Trump won Michigan, 59% of the voters in that Republican primary hate, despise, can't stand the Republican leadership in Washington. They think it's totally ineffective. Fox poll last night basically has a similar number, 63% in Ohio next week, where you've got a governor who's got a 72% approval rating, John Kasich, but they just don't like what's going on in Washington. I think that's a part of it. I think many people rose up, became part of the Tea Party, elected a Republican Congress 6 years ago, elected a Republican Senate, and they don't see anything really changing. And I think the frustration, and the amazing thing to me, is the Republican Party has never been stronger, at least in modern times. We've got 30 governorships. We have control of two-thirds of the legislatures, deep control. We've got this U.S. Senate with a margin, and we've got a big margin in the House that will be maintained. And yet we can't find, and we had probably the strongest field I've seen since 1980 running for president. We had 17 candidates, a number of very substantial governors and other players who got knocked out before they even a vote was cast. And if I'd have sat here 6 months ago and said Donald Trump's going to be on his way to be the nominee of our party, as I said, I'd have lost my fellowship. I would have basically not been ever invited back to this university. Meena and I and Richard Himmelfeld teach a course in American Presidency. We sort of go through all the things that you need to be a great leader, communication skills, leadership skills, everywhere. Nowhere in any time we ever taught this is to say, tell it like it is. And that's the overwhelming thing that people say, why did you vote for Donald Trump? He tells it like it is. I don't care if he doesn't have any experience, he tells it like it is. Now, what does that mean? That means that reality TV is the new format. If you want to be a president, don't be a governor, don't be a senator, go be a reality TV show. And so my sense today is I think this thing is narrowed down to Trump and Cruz. The establishment money, there's no establishment party, has spent an extraordinary amount of money against Trump and had no impact whatsoever. There were over 7,000 commercials around the last couple of weeks, probably $15, $20 million spent against him, and hasn't basically dented anything at this point in time, at least that I can see in polls. So my sense is if Trump wins Florida, which he's 20 points ahead, according to Real Clear Politics and a Fox poll done last night, and I think Rubio's on the deathbed, and if he bases somehow, he's a couple points behind Kasich in Ohio, but if he wins those two races, winner take all, 99 delegates in Florida and 66 in Ohio, race is over. They could all go home. If Kasich wins Ohio, he'll stay around, but I don't see where he can win anything because he has no money. And his premise that I can win, once we get to the blue states, I can win, that certainly wasn't proven in Michigan where he came in third. So my sense is Cruz, if it ends up one-on-one, then it's a real race. And Cruz obviously, Cruz has a better campaign, and Cruz can win the closed primaries, meaning where the Republican voters only vote. But I think, and Trump has no campaign. Trump basically is a big airplane, a big personality. He's got some nice young guys that basically sort of do what he wants them to do. But it's not a real campaign in the sense that he has no pollster, he has no media firm or anything that we traditionally think of as campaign tools. So, but I do think he's definitely the odds on to be the nominee of the party.
So on our side, I think there's some of what Ed has said is going on. It is anger. It's also idealism on our side, young people clustering around Bernie, which is a phenomenon that I've seen for a long time. Bernie's basically giving the same speech for 40 years. And now this is a huge issue, income inequality and all these other things. He's sort of an old-line 60s leftist with a class analysis of the world, which happens to be something that's pretty effective right now. And people are really... Young people are idealistic. They tell it like it is. It's always been great for young folks. And I think that's why he's got resonance. I do think there's not as much anger among young people. I think there's a lot of worry about student loans and job prospects and things. But Bernie's always, his appeal is very straightforward. And I think some of Hillary, I am for Hillary, and I'm actively engaged in her campaign, so just as a disclosure. But I
and
do
his
think
brothers that, for Bernie. He's
and
got
my
whole,
brothers
whole
for
family
Democracy for America is working very hard for Bernie. So hopefully there's a cabinet secretaryship in there for somebody, but it may not be me.
Your wife.
Right, I know. I was just the one person who definitely wouldn't do it no matter what. But I think the anger in the electorate is really what is driving a lot of all this. 20% of the voters in New Hampshire who are independent were struggling to decide who they should vote for, Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump. So that ought to tell you a lot. Bernie had been incredibly successful in Vermont. And when I did the first marriage equality bill in the country in 2000, it was not very well received in Vermont, to put it politely. And I had a very charismatic woman who'd run before running against me for governor. And she just got clobbered. I mean, she clobbered me in the northeastern section of the state, which is very conservative. Bernie got every vote she did when he was running for the House on that year, or I guess he was running for the Senate that year. And so he has an ability to appeal to working class white, particularly men. He'd get the veterans vote. He never voted for a war ever. And he'd get the veterans and the American Legion vote because by talking about their benefits and how they're getting screwed by the government and all this other kind of stuff. He's a populist politician. He's very, very successful. And I think, I'm hoping that he wasn't underestimated because I, of course, called Hillary as soon as he got in and said, you guys better be careful about this guy because he really knows what he's doing. He's a very smart politician. And he is. So anger is some of that motivation. I think some of it's idealism. But I think that the business of this country being stalled and there being no progress and nothing happening in Washington is, in fact, what this is all about. And I don't think it's going to go away. It's an extraordinary phenomenon. I've been wrong about Donald Trump every other day, literally, since July 16th when he declared, every single day. In fact, so then I stopped making predictions about his demise because I just kept being wrong. First it was McCain wasn't a war hero, and then the Megyn Kelly stuff, and then one thing after another got worse and worse, and I finally gave up. So then he goes down to South Carolina. In South Carolina, which is arguably the most conservative state in the entire country, with the highest percentage of military retirees of any country, of any state in the country, and one of the highest dependencies on military expenditures for on active duty of any place in the country. And he not only disses the Pope, which nobody would survive in any ordinary year of any, that's not what, you don't do that in American politics, is to go after somebody else's religion or even your own. But then he goes after the Iraq War, and South Carolina, I suspect, had a fairly significantly high percentage of people who were killed in the Iraq War, and says it was a waste of time. And the President of the United States, and Bush is very popular, lied. This sounds like Howard Dean, right? I mean, this, and I couldn't stand it. I said, okay, now he's dead. Well, here we are 3 weeks later, so I'm going to shut up. Glenn, see if we can make some sense out of this.
So the other thing he did is he attacked the most popular governor in the state.
Right.
And he's still beating up on poor old Lindsey Graham, who's dropped out of the race about 6 weeks ago. And the other senator. Every place he goes where he's been endorsed by the establishment, comes back.
Well, I will straddle the line. Let's talk about Trump for a second. The first whiff that I got that this phenomenon was going to happen came in 2008 when I was on covering Capitol Hill, still for Newsday. I think it was for Newsday. It may have been for Politico. It gets all mixed up in my mind. I've had so many damn jobs.
It's all one party.
It's all one thing. Was the first bank bailout vote, the first TARP vote, which I don't know if you guys recall, went down due to overwhelming Republican opposition. Republican leadership whipped for it aggressively, and it still went down anyway. And on that day, this famous moment where Joe Crowley, this big 6'5" congressman from Queens, stood on the floor and said, "The Dow is down 750 points. So the economy looked like it was on the verge of crashing. We all rushed into the Speaker's lobby, which is the area right off of the floor, and we interviewed all these Republicans who had voted against us. And mind you, this is 2 years before the Tea Party came. The Democrats were still the majority. And a bunch of them said off the record that they were voting no and praying yes. Right? And that blew my mind. I was relatively new to Washington, but even I had not experienced that level of cynicism, and I had covered City Hall in New York City, so that tells you something. That flavor, that feeling, that fervor, that anger, not tethered to a desire to govern, is a fairly new element in American politics, and it has been stoked by many, many factors. The fragmentation of mainstream media, the advent of social media, and more than anything, at least at the beginning, talk radio, particularly on the right. That sentiment has jumped over the firewall from congressional politics and is now infecting, particularly on the Republican side, presidential politics. People used to bifurcate these decisions. The electorates in the off years, the midterms, tended to be a more pure distillation of where the party's base was at. Now, that Tea Party fervor that you had previously seen in congressional elections on the right has jumped over, at least in terms of its spirit, and is infecting the Republican electorate. And I think it is very important for people to understand about Donald Trump and Donald Trump's voters that they are less, at this point, and I've spent a fair amount of time on the road this year, particularly in Iowa, New Hampshire, and South Carolina. These are not people who are looking for a governmental outcome. These are not people who are looking for power or even a result. They are looking to vent their frustration, anxiety, and rage. These are ballots that are being cast on an emotional basis. So that explains some of the foment, at least on the Republican side. Question is, as we move to the general election and the stakes become more clear to people, will they demand that their leadership, for instance, knows what the Joint Chiefs of Staff are, or the triad? In terms of potential thermonuclear global warfare, which Donald Trump certainly does not at the moment.
You know, it was a great interview with, not a great, it was a depressing interview with Anderson Cooper that Trump had last night, where he's asked, who are these military advisors that you're going to get? And the only one he had previously mentioned was Larry Korb, who's a fellow, I think at the Center for American Progress in Washington, a liberal think tank. He has no answer. He doesn't know. He has no staff. And the thing I will tell you about having covered the White House for 3.5 years is, when you have a president who doesn't know anything about how to run the country, that doesn't make them more independent or more likely to make good decisions. It makes them dependent on staff. So the people that they bring in are the ones who are going to be running the country. So to me, from a governance perspective, and I have the unfortunate burden of being somebody who covers politics from a government perspective, because I think of, shoot me to hell, I think of what the implications of this stuff is going to be. I think Donald Trump being singularly uninformed will make him a singularly staff-dependent president. Now, on the Democratic side, that is, as Governor Dean put it, and he knows this far better than I do, the Sanders phenomenon is this hybrid of sort of frustration and idealism that we have seen on the left. I think a lot of progressives are not satisfied with the extent of President Obama's presidency, particularly, it's not just the income inequality issue. It has to do, I think, symbolically, but also substantively, with his failure to force his Attorney General Eric Holder to do prosecutions on Wall Street. And again, just a general sense of gridlock, malaise, an attempt to compromise that wasn't met with anything on the other side. The other thing that Governor Dean alluded to, and I think people really have got to start understanding this about Bernie Sanders, and it was more apparent last night than it was in any venue that I have seen thus far in the campaign. Bernie Sanders is the slickest, most disciplined, most message-centric candidate running on either side in either party in this election. In fact, he is the most disciplined candidate since Barack Obama. In fact, he is more disciplined than Barack Obama. If you go down the line and look at the debate last night, virtually everything that Bernie Sanders said, all the laugh lines, all the applause lines, he has said over and over unrelentingly during this campaign. Again, as Governor, I keep deferring to Governor Dean, but as Governor Dean said before, the man has been giving the same speech for 40 years. Well, he's certainly been giving the same debate performance for 7 debates now. And Hillary Clinton, talk a little bit about Hillary. I'm a little bit of a Hillaryologist. I was sent down by Newsday in 2005 to cover her reelect and then her aborted presidential campaign. I spent 225 days on the road with her in 2008. Hillary Clinton is a terrible politician, ladies and gentlemen. I think this has been proven over and over and over again. She said it. She admitted it last night. Huge internally on her campaign. This has been a huge wrestling match for months and months and months to get her to admit that she's crappy. Okay, but she is. If you looked at the way she tried to attack Sanders last night, it was awful. Scattershot attacks, portraying him as being to the right, you know, like a lot. Portraying him as somebody who was in line with the Minutemen in Arizona. No Democratic voter believes that Bernie Sanders is a right-wing anti-immigrant person. But she's been hitting him with these kitchen sink attacks, and that's because she does not have a coherent narrative for a negative narrative. People talk about coherent narrative, the candidate has to present a narrative. Hillary Clinton does actually have a coherent narrative. She believes her experience entitles her to be president of the United States. That's a perfectly rational argument. The problem is, it didn't sell in 2008, and sure as hell isn't going to sell right now in 2016. People are not looking for that. The base of the party isn't looking for that. Her mistake here, I'm sorry I'm going on so long, but her mistake here, I think, is she does not have a coherent narrative for her opponent. A lot of people, this is an important thing I think people don't understand about politics. It's most of the movement in politics these days is negative movement. You not only have to have a coherent narrative for yourself as a candidate, you have to have a coherent narrative for why the person you are opposing shouldn't be elected. And her narrative for Bernie Sanders is non-existent. So he has a narrative for her, a negative narrative. She is a tool of Wall Street and yesterday's news, even though he is older than her, right? She does not have a narrative for him because she is taking advice from 500 different advisors on conference calls that I am told go on for 3 hours with 19 people on them. So Hillary Clinton will very, very likely, that said, is very, very likely to be the nominee of the party. The math does not work for Sanders at this point in time. And I think Democrats are hoping that she's going to learn some lessons
in terms of her incapacity to define Bernie Sanders going forward with Donald Trump. Because I'm telling you, you know, people, well, I think there's a lot of smugness on the left about Trump being a dream candidate. He is an asymmetrical threat. He could really give her a lot of trouble.
Glenn, just a quick follow-up on discipline. The point you make about Bernie Sanders, a lot of commentators have been saying the same thing about Senator Cruz. What would you say? And this is really what's propelling the Cruz, making Cruz the alternative to Trump, the extreme discipline, not just of the candidate, but of his organization. Is that, have you observed that in following this race?
Well, I mean, Ed, I'll answer that briefly. Ed, I think it could really speak to that. But yes, I think Cruz, but even Cruz has been thrown off. You know, Ted Cruz, lock solid with evangelicals, is getting creamed on evangelicals by Trump inexplicably in Iowa and also in South Carolina and Michigan. But I think he has been knocked off his game. And the funny thing about it is, like, I was getting emails. I've been getting emails. I'm sure you guys do too, from liberals who are like cheering for Ted Cruz, which is the most.
Plus, we had Meghan McCain came out for him.
That's right. Yes.
She said, "I'm not ready for him. My dad hates him, but if Carly Fiona Arena says it's good enough for me." My experience, and one of the problems, I think I can say this, having observed my party for a long time, the Republican National Committee has sort of created the new strategists, and they all basically think the first thing they got to do is go out and create a campaign like Walker did, put 100 people in Madison, Wisconsin, and put 3 people in Iowa, where you've got to win. So the RNC basically thinks they've got to put their big national headquarters every place they run a campaign, and they run out of money. Where the Obama team was like, sleep in sleeping bags, eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, the way that I learned politics. Go live in New Hampshire, go live in Iowa. The Cruz people are that way. They're not national players. They're very good operatives, but they come from Missouri, they come from Iowa, they come from out there. And they don't want to be part of the establishment in D.C., and they know how to basically go out and get voters. So any of these closed, when I say closed, it means Republican-only caucuses or primaries, they do very well. When they get overwhelmed is when they go to the open ones where Democrats and independents could vote. So as we move down the road here, there's a lot more closed. So if Cruz knocks out Rubio next week, and I think he may very well, what Cruz has done as a part of a strategy, he's opened 10 headquarters in Florida, and his whole drill is go knock Rubio out, go compete with Rubio in Florida, not to win, but to take Rubio out of the mix, make Rubio third or fourth, and then basically it's me and Trump. If Kasich loses, then it's really the two of them. Even if Kasich wins, I don't think he goes much beyond that. So his plan is not to have the contested primary, his plan, or contested convention. His plan, and a very effective plan, is let's beat him before we get to the convention. And I can't say he can do it or not can do it, but I can say that I think they're better prepared for it than anybody else's.
Most of, if not all, of the presidential campaigns, maybe the last 7 cycles, have been decided by a handful of suburban communities in a handful of swing states. If you look at Trump's performance in any of those states so far, and same thing with Sanders, they haven't performed well in these swing suburban communities. So is that an underlying weakness for them as general election candidates, or can they put together a coalition of angry people in suburban communities that haven't fully come back from the Great Recession? How do you think this is going to play out?
Well, first, let me take 2 seconds to defend Hillary, my candidate, against Glenn's rather.
She's done very well in suburban communities.
Yes,
so far.
She has. That was going to be one of the best. What reminded me of it. You know, I think Hillary is not the politician her husband is, but who nobody is. We haven't seen a politician like that since Franklin Roosevelt, including Jack Kennedy. So I think what Hillary is selling and does have a compelling narrative about is, actually, particularly issues around children, education, the stuff that she spent her whole life on. And I do think that's a narrative. I think that narrative is probably more interesting to women voters than it is to men voters. I also think that she struggles with Bernie because Bernie's a handful. And I've seen a lot of good politicians run against Bernie and make a lot of mistakes, and they get blown away by their own mistakes. He's fantastic at jiu-jitsu. If you know, here, his people took data from Hillary, and 25 times they went into her database, four separate email accounts. Those are 25 felonies, and by the end of the day, it was a DNC plot against Bernie, and it was cranking up his donations, and I think he raised $1 million off it, and he's very, very good.
I think he raised $3 million.
Yeah, I think you're right. So I would just say, I think Hillary is actually, I agree with her own words that she's not a fantastic politician, but I do think she's A, substantive, B, I think she's the only actual person left in the race, with exception of Kasich, that's qualified to be the president of the United States, and C, I think there's a bit of dog whistling in this campaign in sort of an odd way. Dog whistling, I think women hear her better than men hear her. And I think that's going to help her a lot in the suburbs. And that, because, you know, I always say, if you want to find out what's going to happen in American elections, look at the collar suburbs of Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. They're Republican, and look at particularly women. As soon as I realized what Sarah Palin was about, I realized that McCain had lost, not because she didn't know about the geography of Alaska and Russia, but because Sarah Palin appealed to the same demographic group that McCain himself is, which is 60-year-old white guys. And when women see somebody who's attractive and sexy and skins a moose with her bare hands, that doesn't turn on women, that turns on white, older men. And that is what, and I knew she was dead in the collar, because she was
not all white older men.
Some white older men, more than would admit it. Right, and I'll tell you how I knew this. I ran against somebody like Sarah Palin, and she was very charismatic, very smart, even though not well educated. I'd go through and she was a legislator. I used to go through the legislature. You know, you go through and shake hands with everybody once in a while because you need everybody's vote and all this. I'd go through, and she'd be sitting at a table, the biggest table in the dining room, in the legislative dining room, with 20 seats in it. Every seat would be occupied. Every single one would be an older white male sopping up Ruth's words, you know, just gaping. And I thought, damn. I now figured out who Sarah Palin really is, and it's going to kill McCain. And it did. So I don't think anybody could have won the Republican nomination. I mean, the Dow dropped, and the economy was going to hell, and so forth and so on. So I think we would beat anybody. But I think women, Republican women in the collar counties of Philadelphia, who actually represent moderate Republican women all over the country, are going to vote for Hillary Clinton in droves. In this election, because she, in fact, is very substantive. And I think particularly well-educated women are going to hear what she's really about more easily than some of the rest of us.
I would argue a counterpoint. And the counterpoint is, to begin with numbers, I'm not arguing that Trump is going to win. I'm going to argue Trump's probably going to be the nominee. The country is very divided. There are 20 states that are blue states, and there are 20 states that are red states, and they've been that way for a period of time. Democrats begin with about 246 electoral votes before you even start, which means they've got to get 24 to win the nomination. So no matter who runs, it's a real inside drawing to an inside straight. We begin with 179, and we need to get 91 out of the 113 that are left. So no matter who our candidate is, going to be a very significant part. What we don't know, and I think anybody that's done this for a long time, we can argue about suburban voters and women and all the rest of it, and 50% of the Republicans still aren't very happy with the Trump nominee. But there's a phenomenon there, and he may very well stir up a lot of things that are going to happen. And he's a street fighter. I mean, and he's probably the greatest marketeer that I've ever seen in my life. The fact that many of you in this room sat and watched an hour commercial the other night after his victories, selling steaks, water, Chinese ties, and all the rest of it, and every network hung in there. And poor old Hillary Clinton, MSNBC, who had a victory, MSNBC filmed it and ran it 3 hours later, 2 o'clock in the morning. And none of the other candidates had any kind of show. So he does know how to market, even from the point of view of putting a podium up on the last two election days, and all day long, Fox or MSNBC, they focus on we've now got a tour of all of his golf courses in Florida. And I promise you, he's going to kick tail in Florida this coming week. So I think the reality of arguing about where women are going to, both parties, voters have been pretty partisan. It's been about an 85% vote rate. And I just don't know where the dynamic is. I can't imagine him losing any of the states that Romney, you know, it may happen, but I'm very doubtful. And I think a couple states may be in play if he turns out to be a good candidate. He can't be the candidate he is now and be a viable candidate.
Well, the one thing I would just add to both of them is the number that I'd be watching on Trump right now is his disapproval among Republican voters is rising, which is counterintuitive and is a warning sign. So I think
the real danger for Trump is as he's moving to these sort of unaffiliated voters, his opponents called them fans, right? He might be, there'll be some erosion on the right. And people like, I did a podcast with Rick Tyler, who was his former communications director, Cruz's. And he basically said to me that, yeah, they signed the pledge. Cruz signed the pledge that he's going to support Trump. But all the guys on the right are going to sit on their hands, even if there's not a third party candidacy. So there's going to be significant erosion in terms of the Republican base. And Hillary is in an opposite situation. This is actually her strongest asset. Even Bernie Sanders voters, and I saw this illustrated in Iowa City more than any other place I was at. Huge bastion for Obama, young voters, huge bastion for Bernie. I must have interviewed 30 younger voters coming out of a Bernie rally. Not a single one of them had a really negative thing to say about her. Her general, you know, her trustworthy numbers stink, but her general approval in terms of Democratic and progressive voters is very strong. And a lot of people who vote for Bernie say, I'm voting for Bernie, but if she's the if she's the party's nominee, I have no problem with that. So that's really her core strength, I think.
What I'm I have a bunch of these money guys who are coming, who are desperate to try and stop Trump, and they have no clue of how to do it. And they come to me and they say, you know, come out of retirement, go back, we'll make you rich. And I'll see you make me dead. You know, 73 years old, I should have quit in 1984 with Reagan. But what some of them are now saying, I think they're going to go hard one more week against Trump, and I expect a week from today that we'll know whether Trump has won Florida, and certainly going to win Florida, and if he's won Ohio, and then I think you're going to see a kind of a lot of people come around. What the big money people are now starting to say, who obviously have a big impact on not necessarily making nominees or net presidents, let's put our money into protecting the Senate. Let's not lose the Senate. And what difference is it? We have Hillary for four more years. We've had Obama for 8 years. You know, let's make sure we hold the Congress. So I think you're going to find a lot of that happening. Equally as important, Trump, who spent absolutely no money, he spent less money than anybody in this campaign, and in spite of all the talks of billions and what have you, has gone to the RNC saying, I need $1 billion to run the fall campaign, which I'm sure is a minimum number.
Did Trump run ads on Super Tuesday?
He ran $100,000 worth of ads. Right. $1 million worth of ads, which is like...
That's amazing, guys. I don't think you understand.
It's like running for student body president.
No, it's like if you showed up at the Super Bowl and decided to play four players.
Yeah.
And still won anyway.
Absolutely. Yeah. And he bragged about it. So, you know, I made a buy, $1 million buy.
He's the only guy who may have, presidential candidate, who actually may have made money.
That's right.
No joke.
Well, let me be the outlier. The point is, when you go to the fall, and you've got all this free television, you've got 70% of all television since June 16th. He faked you out for a month. You said July 2nd. Right. So you had a month run on stardom just before you noticed him. TV is not going to be give him the whole game. I mean, it's going to be a campaign, and if they put him on, they got to put Hillary on. Hillary's not going to want to be on Fox News 17 times a day in her pajamas. Which is what he's done. So my sense is the paid campaign is going to be enormous. And
I'm stealing the pajamas. What?
You could have it. You could have any. I steal from you every day. So just basically, you could have anything I have. So I mean, you're going to have a real campaign in the fall, and you're going to have a big, expensive campaign. And I think she probably will have somewhere in the neighborhood of $2 billion. Most of that spent on television. There's so much stuff to pound away on Trump. All you have to do is get all the Howard Stern tapes when Howard Stern were on talking about girlfriends and stuff. So I think he's in for a real battle. And what I've discovered watching him is, like many narcissists, which clearly he is, they don't like to be attacked. And anytime he gets attacked, he really loses his cool. And he's had two miserable debates, and it doesn't stop. I mean, I go back to the point of Lindsey Graham. Lindsey Graham has not been a factor in a year. And he still, every chance he gets, I want to pop at Lindsey. He's going to be popping at midget Rubio forever. And the reality, that's just the way he is. He started out the other night with a unity speech that was pretty good, and then he can't resist. He gets off in the after he's selling the steaks and the water and all the rest of it. Then he gets into the slamming song. So my sense, if he gets some people in and he has nobody in there today who can run a real campaign, then it may be a credible campaign. If not, the mob scene, and I did Ross Perot, my great distinction, Ross Perot had 39% of the vote, the national vote, in June of 1992. And Hamilton Jordan and I got him down to 19% in a month. with a major assist from Ross, of course. But at the end of the day, if Trump doesn't put a real campaign together, he can have a real erosion. I also think Hillary has a tougher task getting these young voters back into the camp. And I don't think it's going to make a difference in the election, but I think long-term as a party, you've got a lot of work to do. This is sort of their first crusade. This is like those of us that are older, the McCarthy campaigns of 68 and what have you. And you have great affection for that. So
let me just, 2 seconds. I want to be the outlier. I actually think Trump is not a foregone conclusion. I think Cruz is actually much more dangerous than Trump is if one of the two of them had to be president. Because I actually fundamentally don't think there's any evidence that Cruz believes in democracy. And I think he's a much better politician. He's not a good marketer. So I don't think this thing is over by any stretch of the imagination. I think Cruz is very smart. He is also a complete narcissist. But we'll see. I think it's interesting. I don't think this is a foregone conclusion. I think Trump's got to do really... If Trump runs the table on Tuesday, then I think we're close to a foregone conclusion. But I don't think he's going to.
Let's not forget the two big races this weekend. You have the District of Columbia and Guam. If he takes those two, then you know you're in trouble.
Well, if I can pick up on that, it's hard to make foregone conclusions in this race.
Yes.
It looks as though the Rubio campaign is about done, unless something surprising happens in Florida. But we were talking about money. There have been several articles written over the last 48 hours. The Rubio campaign doesn't have any money in Florida. They're relying on super PACs. The energy seems to have gone out of the campaign. Glenn, after Super Tuesday, you wrote, I love your 5 takeaways. They're great for testing students. They're very testable. Good list. But you asked, well, the last question after Super Tuesday was, did John Kasich ref Rubio? Which I think is a topic we can discuss. But the articles that are coming out this week seem to suggest that after Michigan, after he didn't even get the threshold in Michigan and Mississippi, that Rubio may have wrecked Rubio, particularly with some of the comments before Super Tuesday.
Which were totally great about, like, Trump. What was the thing that he said when Trump threatened to sue the news media? He said you should sue some whoever did that to your face.
Rubio said yesterday, right, that he embarrassed
that
his
he embarrassed himself.
I guess the question is, what led to... what caused the problems in the Rubio campaign, and what is his political future?
There are a couple of things. First of all, Rubio is electorally a man without a country. Okay, that's the initial predicate. He right. looks great on paper. He seems to thread the needle that particularly us in the media see as being needed, that needs to be threaded in the Republican Party. Just conservative enough, just moderate enough. The problem is, as you can see it in Florida, there's no real loyalty. He does well in sort of the suburbs. He did enormously well. I think probably his high point, even though he's won Minnesota and Puerto Rico, his high point was a strong performance in the Northern Virginia suburbs. And it's funny, the day after he lost the Virginia primary to Trump, they showed the Rubio map of Virginia, and it was the Obama map of Virginia. So Rubio did not have a path to the presidency. What he had was 4 guys in a Capitol Hill row house who thought they were smarter than everybody, and they were very, very smart. They are very, very smart, who thought they could run kind of a stealth campaign, but it was all predicated on the mistaken notion that we all made that Trump would implode at some point in time. Trump's strength has made Rubio a non-factor. And so what you really have to look at is not that Rubio made all these mistakes, it's that Rubio didn't have a chance, given the environment, and he took desperate measures, and he, you know, at that debate, you were essentially watching the political equivalent of a suicide bomber. He was reputationally devastating himself in hopes that he could take Trump out with a haymaker. When that didn't work, you literally saw, and I don't think we've seen this sort of I guess we saw it with Scott Walker was the biggest implosion of the campaign. But Rubio, within a week's time, was just dead, and he's been dead ever since.
Any comments on is there a future for Rubio and the Rubio and the Republican Party?
The danger he faces, I mean, if he gets buried in Florida, and again, to the point that you made, obviously accurately caught it, he had no traditional campaign. He always was going to be the media darling, and as you say, Trump stole all that space. He's very articulate, and he had the optimistic, upbeat, and a great story to tell. And when they got into combat, they weren't prepared for combat anywhere. The issue in Florida, he totally made a mistake you know, and he had this rivalry with Bush, and they'd once been friends, and Bush had been his mentor. Bush accidentally spent some of the $141 million that he had to spend outside of Mike Murphy's grasp on some stuff in Florida, because, and they did absentee ballots and what have you, and they vote an absentee ballot early. Rubio made a choice not to get in there, and the argument he made in your publication was, I knew there was still Bush, I didn't want to be turning out Bush. Right. So there's several hundred thousand votes that have been cast already that are probably for Bush. So the field he has is much smaller. And he could easily come in, I just as we're talking earlier about collapse, he's definitely going to come in third.
Yeah.
He could easily come in fourth.
It's amazing.
In the state that he's the senator of. I think if that happens, and I think what these people are arguing with him now about dropping out or looking to his future, not to his present, is if you get beat in your home state and you come in third or fourth, there is no governor's mansion for you in the future, and you know you're going to become a national something or other.
You and Charlie Crist are having dinner together.
Yeah, and I think that's the issue that's going on today. So it's a very serious discussion.
So before we go to questions, would you guys like to try handicapping? I know in this year it's something we all try to avoid. The head-to-heads, the possible head-to-heads in November, Clinton-Trump, Sanders-Trump, et cetera, et cetera.
Sanders-Trump obviously is my favorite race. I mean, if I got to have Trump, I want Sanders on the other side. I think that's equal, but who knows?
I think it's a very, I am totally gun-shy because I've been wrong. Yeah, I would say my wrong percentages have been about 98%. That's pretty good. I mean, I've never heard of anybody who survived in the majors with a .002 batting average, which is what mine is. So, I'm for Hillary, so I'm for her because I actually think she'd be the best president by far. I think at the end of the day, anger matters a lot in politics, but so does common sense, and there are a lot of people who either aren't voting in these primaries or aren't that interested in it and don't have a lot of intensity who are going to sit and look at the candidates and think, can I see this person as president? And if the answer to that is no, they're not going to vote for Trump or Cruz, or Bernie for that matter, from the other side. So my own personal view is that Hillary's the best candidate for us given this field. I agree with Ed that Kasich has no shot, even though he may win Ohio. So I think Hillary will win because I think at the end of the day, I think people widely acknowledge that she can do the job. And I think people are going to have a lot of doubts about Cruz and Trump. Sanders is the most interesting for me because that really, ideology is going to have something to do with it. I mean, that you're going to get the polarized election that you always get, 40% for the Republicans and 40% for the Democrats. And then the question is, where are the suburban independents going to go in that race, Bernie Sanders against either Trump or Cruz? I don't know. I do not know. So that's the first variable. The second variable is turnout. Does a Bernie Sanders get you an enormous turnout that it is motivated by the sense of anger or the sense of fear about the future? Because that's going to be a much bigger factor than it usually is in elections. It's always a factor in elections, but this year it's going to be a really big election. And then the other last question is, given the numbers in the big states, what happens to the African-American Hispanic votes? We cannot win in the Democratic side without very substantial turnout. And there's not been a lot of evidence that African-Americans or Hispanics have been motivated to turn out in great numbers by Bernie. Younger people in those demographics, maybe a little more so, but the numbers that Hillary is drawing in the South are just stunning, stunning among African-Americans. So I don't know. I think it's fascinating. I don't know the question.
I just want to make sure no one thinks I think Bernie Sanders is going to be the nominee. I think Hillary is going to be the nominee. I do think Trump is going to be the nominee. He's not my nominee, but he's, I'm a Republican, so I'll vote for him, and I live in New York, so it doesn't make damn the difference.
he's telling everybody he's going to win New York. I think there is, I'll make two predictions. I think there is a 100% chance that I will personally be very depressed. Because it's going to be a combination of infotainment and relentless negativity on both sides.
The nastiest campaign we've ever seen.
Right, and I think actually Bernie Sanders is the one ray of sunshine here because, like, you know, you ask the Clinton people, how are you going to deal with this 7-1 or whatever deficit she has with under 30s, under 40s, for God's sakes. Right? We're not talking under, just under 30s. We're talking under 40s really just go for Sanders. And their answer is, we get Bernie Sanders, right? And I actually did an interview with Tad Devine, her top strategist, a couple of days ago, and I got him in trouble because I said, you know, their strategy for getting out the youth vote in general election against Donald Trump is Bernie Sanders. And then Tad Devine's like, well, are they going to put him on the ticket? You know, Bernie did not like that. So I think it's going to be, as Ed said, a relentlessly negative campaign. The person who I respect most in terms of understanding Democratic turnout and the Democratic electorate, and this is about turning your voters out, particularly blacks and Latinos on the Democratic side, is David Plouffe, who is now with Hillary and was the 2008 campaign manager for Obama and the de facto 2012 campaign manager for Obama. And he predicts a Trump, he's the smartest guy I know on this stuff. He predicts a Trump-Clinton matchup would yield a historic loss of the Republicans. He thinks, and by historic, he means a 6-to-8-point win for Hillary Clinton. So, I mean, I wouldn't put my money in the bank on that, but he's the smartest person I know.
I could argue that very same thing. What I don't think it does, though, is people are saying to me, well, it's going to be a Goldwater. And I'm saying it's not going to be a Goldwater. We're not going to lose the South. We're not going to lose. I mean, there may be one or two states different, going to your point about the suburban vote. I mean, we've got the 20 states we have are pretty solid, and my sense is we may not do much on the swing states, but we certainly going to have that. Because there's going to be a big effort to get out our vote for the sake of the Senate and the House.
Well, we're certainly not depressed now. I think it's there's just such an element of surprise in this election that while Larry and I have many more questions, we'd like to open it up. I think we're, Kathleen's moving we have the mics in the aisles, and I think we're asking people, Kathleen, to line up, if you will. We'd like to get in as many questions as possible. So if I guess someone's positioned well for the first question there. If you could keep the question short and let us know to whom you're directing it. Why don't we, Rachel, you're set up well if you have a question.
Here's the question I have. Either if it comes down to Trump, and it comes down to Hillary, do you think either candidate has the power to be more than a one-term president?
It's going to be a challenge. Going to be a challenge for either one of them to be a one-term president.
That's right.
I think, from our perspective, it would be like the third term of Obama. She will basically be quite old by the time she runs for re-election, and I'm that age now. So I mean. Does she have the energy to go another, be White House president and go again? And I think there's kind of trends that go back and forth. So my sense is it would be very difficult for her to be a two-term president, but that's foolish to try and think about that. If Trump ended up being the president, I think impeachment might come along somewhere midterm. serving out his term would be a real challenge, but
this is getting really to be fun. I've never.
And by the way, he's impeachment, even if the Republicans hold the House.
Oh, absolutely.
Right.
Probably more
maybe,
likely.
Maybe especially if the Republicans hold the House.
So it depends who he picks as the vice president. That's why Trump has to be careful who he picks as vice president. That's why he won't pick Paul Ryan.
Well, I think Sarah Palin's experienced. She was the first one to endorse him.
Rested and ready.
It'll make the media say, well, she now has some experience in the race.
Good point. So I've thought about this a lot because, of course, it's harder to be, given the pattern of the post-Roosevelt Truman administration, it would be hard. This would be the first time you'd had 16 years of any party in the White House. I think it is possible, and I think this is true. I've known Hillary for a long time. She's very capable and very smart. B, if you look at her Senate record, she actually does work well with Republicans. And if the Republicans decide, and I think they will, if Trump is the nominee, or even if Hillary beats Cruz to get this, the Republicans are totally changed their party around, going to do the best they can. They're going to find that this being the party of no has been a disaster for them. So if there's willingness on the Republican side to work, I think they're going to have a willing partner in Hillary. Now, she can't say that during the primaries. The truth is, I think she did get some stuff done in the 8 years in the Senate and make some compromises, some of which she's been pilloried for in the debates. But that's what's going to have to happen. If she does that, And I think the country's going to be better off after 4 years of Hillary Clinton. My guess is she gets reelected.
The only thing that I add from covering the White House is I think increasingly the amount of power that a president has to control his or her own destiny is decreasing by the day. And I think so much of what happens now is exogenous, that the president can't control.
I think you're absolutely right.
I think we have this, Professor Bengel's first, and then we'll do the two questions.
I'm very nervous making any statement with my students here because it's going to sound political. But if Trump wins, and I'm aging rapidly thinking about it, and I'm not young to begin with, what happens to all the hate he's engendered in this country, especially about minorities? That's number one. And number two, there was a general or something on Bill Maher's show recently who said that if push came to shove, the military wouldn't even go into a war situation if they felt it was illegal and Trump was ordering them to go. So it's sort of
I'm not a Trump expert. I've become one in the last several weeks here, months, watching him. I do know a lot about the presidency, and I do think, the interesting thing is people talk about the bosses and people talk about the elite and they talk about, and there's none of that. Haley Barbour, who was one of my deputies in the White House, I bought him from Mississippi, was a great chairman. And if Haley Barbour was still the chairman, he'd have Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell and these two candidates that are left in the room and he'd say, listen, let's get a common agenda here. You're going to have Trump out running on one agenda, the Senate now talking about running on a separate agenda. And the truth of the matter is, the Republicans, who I talked about having great strength, the 30 governors are not going to change their philosophy. The legislatures are not going to change their philosophy. We've always been we're not an isolationist party. So I think if he doesn't go along with Ryan and some others, he's going to have some real internal fights. Now, obviously, a president can go so far, and this president, once he reached if Trump became the president, once he read the Constitution, he'd realize how far he couldn't go. But at the end of the day, I think what worries me as a Republican who spent a long period of my life trying to build a party, I believe in addition. I believe in adding voters. And we now have two minority parties that are shrinking. And I think it's very important when you look at demographics, the growing Hispanic and Asian population of the future and the extraordinary important issues like immigration are not going to get untarred by this discussion that's going on now. And Trump may say these kinds of things that are very hateful, but it's going to stick on this party. That's what worries me as someone who has a Chinese daughter, as a matter of fact, who's fully in Hillary's camp and has been since she was 2 years old. But at the end of the day, I just worry about, are we going to become as a party pegged as a hateful party, as opposed to the Paul Ryans of the world, who are extremely thoughtful and someone who I think could do great things if he gets to be speaker for a period of time.
I think we were waiting for two questions here. Both of you waited. So we'll do that, and then we'll come back over here. Go ahead.
So I just have a thought, question about for all of you. With the Michigan primary upset that happened a couple days ago, where Bernie narrowly won the state, do you think that there's any kind of chance of that happening on the Republican side, maybe later, given the percent error that happened there?
You know, if this thing comes down to a place like California, which is the last one, and it's obviously a giant block of, and California is a very unique situation where each congressional district basically is up for grabs. So you go to Nancy Pelosi's congressional district in San Francisco, and there's probably 200 Republicans. If you get 50 of those Republicans, you probably win those three delegations. It's a winner-take-all congressional district by congressional district and statewide. So I think that's where Cruz may be very effective. Historically, what's happened is the campaigns, the establishment candidate hasn't wrapped up by now, and everybody else folds because they have no money. Cruz is going to have money, and Cruz has the ability to continue to raise money. And my sense is you're going to see even more than the Reagan campaign, which I was involved in 76, the Reagan-Ford battle. The conservatives are really, really out there and very, very unhappy. I don't think they can find a third-party candidate, and I think it would be a suicide mission. But they are not going to, you talk about suburban women, the conservatives are basically not going to buy into the Trump. They're going to fight Trump all the way, and Cruz will be their vehicle. And Cruz is very, very articulate. I don't share all of your concerns. I mean, I think he believes in a democracy, but just thinks they ought to be run by a benevolent dictator. and I'm not so sure that's a wrong governing phrase at this point. I did work for Nixon. But at the end of the day, our party has to really redesign ourselves. And part of the dilemma we face by starting in a place, and the evangelical had such a critical role in all of this over the last several cycles. The evangelicals are split all over the place now. They're not, a guy that's been married three times, had a child out of wedlock, who's our front runner, is taking the evangelical role, who basically throws a $100 bill in the communion plate and stands up and says, I'm a Christian, and that's good enough for the Christian coalition. And no disrespect to any of it, but it just, I mean, to me, this is just having catered to that community forever to all of a sudden see them, you know, like, okay.
But one thing I would say is there is a fantastic blueprint for precisely the party that you have described, and it was written by Jeb Bush and his team for the Republican National Committee right after 2012.
Right.
And that thing has been shredded, trashed, set on fire, you know, made into paper.
The thing we haven't talked about, which is really fascinating, if we go to a convention in Cleveland is a city that has a large African-American community, so Black Lives Matter could be a very front and center thing. A very large union, large union population. The Teamsters control much of Cleveland. That if we get into a Donnybrook in that city, you know, we should be in Columbus, but we're in Cleveland, it could be a real...
That is a great story idea. Thank you.
Well, finally, I give you something.
It's the sons of the Reagan Democrats.
Well, it's the 68 equivalent of what happened with the Democrats. So you get in a Donnybrook, and no matter what happens here, if it's Cruz and Trump, their supporters are not all going to go, you know, mea culpa, we're, you know, we all love each other. They're not. And it's going to be a real battle. And some other things nobody thinks about. We don't have a permanent rules committee like he had in the DNC, which we pick two people from each state. We have 100 people for a rules committee that comes in a week in advance. And the way our rules are written, you can rewrite rules. And even though the states sort of pick how delegates are picked, and you're supposed to stay in the camp for one vote, you know, if all of a sudden you get 60 Trump players, or more likely you're going to have 60 Cruz players, and equally as important, there's been no effort to pick delegates. These guys are winning delegates, but they don't know how to pick delegates. So the Trump people probably end up with a bunch of people who have fought them all the way who know how to become delegates, because I've been to 5 conventions or 8 conventions or what have you, and I want to keep wearing the badges. So you've got, it's not like you've got a whole bunch of people who... you know, really going to go there and be very orderly. So you could have a convention, maybe not the contestant that everybody's waited for since 76, but you could have a chaotic convention. And then they're trying to rewrite a platform that basically the Trump has never read, most Republicans have never read, that is totally contrary to everything he's saying out there. Nothing in there about building a 15-foot wall for $8 billion.
Great point.
I think Brianna, you've been waiting a while.
Sorry, I didn't mean to
I know you gave up your spot, so let's turn to you, and then we'll circle back.
So if Trump were to win the nomination and eventually take the presidency, how do you feel that this would harm the Republican Party and their entire platform to, like, rebrand themselves to be more inclusive towards millennials and just younger voters in general? Like, how do you think that that will eventually affect their appeal?
I will take a contrary view. And Donald Trump's great selling point is his strength, is his steadfastness. It's bull, right? Every time he is asked, there were 3 or 4 examples in the last week where he made an outrageous statement. Last night on Anderson Cooper, he said during the debate, it was a big applause line, that he would hunt down the families of terrorists. He sits on Anderson Cooper, he's like, well, I didn't mean I was going to kill him. I'm going to hunt him down, right? Buy him lunch. I don't know what the hell he was talking about. So it is my belief that Donald Trump, the minute that hand would be raised, and I'm not necessarily sure that moment will occur, I think he is going to run. I think Trump is generally fairly conservative on these issues. But, you know, the rumor was, my buddy Ben Smith wrote a deliciously irresponsible story for BuzzFeed the other day about this, was that Trump flip-flopped during a meeting of the New York Times editorial board where he said, the wall thing's kind of negotiable. That's the rumor. I'm sitting up here telling rumors. But I think there is a sense that Trump is transactional and will go wherever the weather leads him. And I think
he is very eager, and you could see it at the beginning of that Mar-a-Lago, that 45-minute stand-up routine he did in Mar-a-Lago.
Infomercial.
I thought it was more like, you know, kind of
Caesar's. Home shopping.
Kind of like QVC. Yeah, QVC.
Yeah, it was kind of, it was like Joan Rivers, like Joan Rivers on QVC. A little comedy, right. A little politics, a little shopping, right? I think you saw there that he's already trying to make this move to the Senate. I'm telling you, he does that, he's really dead. Yeah, if he does that too soon, all those people right. who are disaffected to begin with are going to turn on him.
Yep.
I've kind of a similar question. If Trump becomes the nominee for the Republican Party, does it represent a failure in the party's ability to defeat him?
I personally think the failure of the party, and I've been around the party for a long time, so I'm kind of an expert on their failures, is, again, they always try and run their last election. There's no reason we should not have proportional nominating process all the way. But we decided we didn't want to have this dragged out because John McCain lost because he got dragged out, or Mitt Romney. We want to get him done by March 1st, so therefore, you know, three-quarters of the people in the country in the Republican Party never get to vote. So I think one of the first rules that will get changed will be that. Equally as important, New Hampshire has a right to go first because it's always gone first. Iowa has no business going first. And no disrespect to anybody who's here from Iowa, what have you, but you've been to Iowa 100 times, as have I. It is.
Good idea. You've been to Iowa.
It is. It
all
is,
99 it, counties.
It's a 99% white. It is a social. If you don't talk about pro-life position, you don't talk about agriculture. I mean, the only one who ever broke from the stupid ass sin fuel, whatever they call it, ethanol thing was this time. They hold you hostage. Millions and millions of dollars are spent there. You spend a year freezing ass in this winter and dying in the heat in the summer, you know, meeting every little school kid at some ranch pizza place.
I hope this is, can you put this on video here? This is really,
Why
do you hate America?
No disrespect, but it's just, it should not get to go first.
Wait a second. Reporters love Des Moines.
Sure they do.
You got an open. It's got great bars.
Pork chops. Pork chops.
The beef is right
on
the
epitome.
Bar.
The epitome of Iowa was when Rudy Giuliani went when he made one or two visits there when he was running for president, when he got his one delegate for $150 million or $100 million. He goes. He's staying in the most luxurious hotel in Des Moines, which is like a Holiday Inn down here the road here. He wants to know where the mini bar
is. It's the Marriott.
He said, where's the mini bar? And they said, well, there's no mini bar. He said, well, I'm not staying in any hotel that doesn't have a mini bar. So they discover there's no mini bars anywhere. So his team has to bring around a mini bar everywhere they go and set him up with a mini bar a couple times he went. Now, that wasn't as bad as his two. I asked his advance, how did you spend $65 million in a campaign that lasted, you know, 2 months and never went to Iowa? He said, two jets. If her hair wasn't done, a second jet went. So Iowa demands a lot of the candidates, and I think to a certain extent what we've seen this time is, think of how many candidates got knocked out before a voter cast a vote, and Iowa and the debates was a very significant part of that. So to me, I'm happy to have Iowa. I would have the old Bill Brock, Mo Udall and two different parties came up with it. The first Tuesday of every month for 4 months, you have 10 or 12, draw a name out of the hat, that's your day, then you get 3-4 weeks to go campaign. You spend a year in Iowa, you spend a week in New Hampshire, and then you fly over everything else. And that's not a good democracy process. So.
We have, I think we have three more people who haven't asked questions. Let's see if we can squeeze them all in.
My question is for Governor Dean. If Hillary Clinton offers you to be her running mate, would you accept it?
Wow. This is being recorded, just so you know.
I would advise her not to do that.
I would too.
But you'd do it for a different reason than me. She's going to win Vermont anyway, and there's no reason that she shouldn't pick somebody who would be more helpful to the ticket.
Who do you think would be helpful?
Pardon? I'm not going to speculate on that, only because I find that if you say things publicly that you're saying privately, that never works very well. So I'm going to stay out of that. I also don't believe. And I don't believe that discussion is actually going on. And if it is, that's a very bad idea. I can tell you that from personal experience, because I had that discussion with somebody before a single vote had been cast. And here I am in this panel instead of in a big blue office with a nice rug. So I appreciate the sentiment, but I think I'm not biting.
I have to say, we always try to anticipate questions. I didn't see the good questions. That's I didn't see that one coming. Yeah. Dr. Perotti.
Chairperson.
I want to go back to a comment that Mr. Rollins made earlier, actually earlier in the day. I don't want this party to be like the Know Nothing Party or the Whig Party of the past. And you came here and you talked about, compared the Trump phenomenon to the Theodore Roosevelt phenomenon in 1912. I'm wondering whether this is really a longer term, this portends a longer term change between the two parties, whether this is really more like 1896, where
I wasn't there for 1896. So I couldn't speak in an expertise.
Where the parties fundamentally reconfigure. Is it possible, if Trump and Hillary are the nominees, that the Republican Party becomes the party of nativism and maybe even protectionism, and the Democratic Party becomes the party of internationalism and free trade?
You know, first of all, in the 40 years I've been around Washington in politics, 50 years total, but 40 years from my Washington experience, two parties have changed dramatically. The Democrats used to try and cover everybody from Maxine Waters in L.A. to Southern Democrats, senators. And what's happened in my lifetime is there's no centrist, there's no Southern Democrats, there's no Northeast Republicans, and I think that's all part of the extremism. I think the philosophy has to be redefined. And I think if we want to appeal to young people, we have to become a party that, in my attitude, I'm 73 years old, so I don't care what I say anymore. I care what I believe. I think if you want social issues, and I'm a Catholic and I'm pro-life and I have a daughter that was adopted, I can go to church and find other people who are pro-life with me. If I want gun control or what have you, you can go find like people. I think if we want to reach to young people, we get away from the social issues, we become a party of economic issues, because obviously his party is tied to entitlement programs and what have you, and taxing the rich. My party basically could be about small business, economic freedoms. I think we live in an international world. I would hope both parties would not become isolationist, and that we basically, and I think the immigration policy, I think we need more immigrants, legal immigrants, not illegal immigrants. And I think we need to do something about the 12 or 15 million people that are here. Not throw them out. Don't blow the whistle and say out of the country. Figure out a system or country of 330 million people. We've had a million people come in every year legally. About 600,000 of those are family and friends of people who are here. We're a big country. We can absorb a lot. And we basically want to bring people to our universities, and we want to keep them, not kick them out. And somehow you've got to get the people who are here in line and allow them to become a place of citizenship. Now, I can't say this, I'm already called every name in the book, but I think as a party, we need to start addressing those kinds of issues.
So one thing I'd say on the Democratic side, and the questioner mentioned the Democrats being this internationalist party. The point that I'd make is just look at the Michigan results. How'd that work for Hillary Clinton being a candidate associated with free trade? That's a no sale for a lot of Democrats right now. So I think there's, in addition to sort of the schism in the Republican Party, I do think that that schism exists in the Democratic Party as well. Not as pronounced, but it's pretty significant.
Mr. Dean, you previously mentioned that you were going to give your vote to Hillary Clinton. My question is, there has been debate about who is the true establishment politician. So my question to you is, what does that really mean to you, and who is the real establishment politician, if any?
Well, I would say they're both somewhat establishment. I mean, Bernie's served in the Senate for, I think, 10 years or something like that, maybe more. And before that, he was in the House, and before that, he was mayor. So his views are not establishment views as defined by, what is more common, which is what I guess establishment is. Why am I supporting Hillary? Because I think she's the most qualified person for the job. She's fact-based. Let me give you one example of this. And I supported Hillary long before Bernie got in the race. I had no idea he was going to get in the race. I thought he wasn't. But she cares what the facts are. And she was asked, just before, when she was getting in, do you have a litmus test for somebody to be on the Supreme Court? Now, the politically correct answer to that is no, everybody's going to be evaluated on their merits and blah, blah, blah. And I know that because I had to make a bunch of those appointments at Vermont. She said, yes, I do. I am going to appoint someone who will undo Citizens United. Now, here's the thought process that, you know, most of us rail against Citizens United, the Koch brothers, and buying elections. That is not the core problem with Citizens United. It's a huge problem, but it's not the core problem. The core problem is that the Supreme Court of the United States of America negated the one phrase in the founding documents of our country that defines for each one of us, every one of us, who we are. And that is, all men are created equal, updated to all people are created equal, obviously. That is the phrase by what most Americans believe defines an American. If you could only pick one phrase of the entire founding documents of our country, it would be that. And the Supreme Court said, no, that's not true. In fact, free speech equals money, and those who have lots of it are entitled to a lot more of it than you might be. So the reason I thought Hillary is not a high-risk person. She is cautious. She is careful. I wouldn't quite say
that. She's very
I wouldn't have said that. I wouldn't have said it the same way Glenn would, but she's not. She's a risk-averse person. For her to say that and make that analysis was extraordinary. It's not a common analysis, but it speaks to the importance. When something has to be done, I believe that Hillary Clinton's going to get it done. And of course there's going to be politics, and it's politics that she's not always comfortable with. But what I want in a candidate, and I think Bernie's got this too, but I think Hillary's got the international experience, which I care deeply about, because I think the fundamental mistake we make as a country internationally, and everybody makes it no matter which party you're in, is we temporize until we absolutely have to do something. And the problem is, if we keep drawing, say, red lines, I'm not, as you know, much of a warmonger from my history, but if you don't do something, it doesn't always have to be armed intervention, early on, you end up paying a much bigger price later on for what you didn't do when you should have. We live in an international world, we have no choice about that. There may be a nativist wing of both parties, I think that's true. I think it's gonna be a long time before anybody runs for president who's gonna be seriously considered who's not an internationalist. The world is so small now that if we had, for example, as Hillary suggested, had a no-fly zone in Syria 2 years ago, 500,000 Syrian refugees that have destabilized the European Union would still be in Syria in a safe place, as actually George H.W. Bush discovered when he had a no-fly zone over Kurdistan. So these are things we have to think ahead. She is more capable of thinking ahead than anybody I know in politics, except possibly her husband. So that's why I supported Hillary. It had nothing to do with establishment versus insurrection versus any of this stuff, or even her positions. I know her really well. I think she's really, really smart, really capable. I think she's very tough-minded, and that's what I want in a president.
We have time for, I think, one more question.
Please forgive me for getting off this wonderful, rational discussion to express how emotional I am about the effect of Trump on our children. Many people are wondering, and they're citing examples of fights at events and doing things to kids who are in a minority in groups. And I really harbor the hope that, as Bob Woodward chastised the people on Morning Joe, where are the investigative journalists to dig up so much dirt that Trump goes up in flames? Really, I think back to the McCarthy era when this wonderful lawyer chastised McCarthy. I forget, I'm bad with names, so I forgot.
Excuse me?
Joe Welch.
Yes. I really am harboring the irrational notion that somebody has got to get this guy because, well, first of all, he said, if you don't treat me fairly, I may not remain in the race or something. Well, I guess he really fully intends to remain, but you can see what I think.
I agree with you. I think before the debate tonight, we ought to have, you know, children and animals warning, put a big R rating across the front, you know.
You can be very amusing and witty about it, but I really feel this as a grandmother.
I would not get too worried about this because I think he is a perfect example of how not to behave to our children. I think most people know that. That's why I don't think he's going to be the next president of the United States. Even if he wins the nomination, which I have some doubts about,
I think he's a perfect example. Sometimes it's not such a bad thing to have role models that you can look at and say, don't ever do this, because this, in fact, is really bad behavior. It's a teachable moment.
Well, what about the role models at his rallies who act abysmal, and they're adults?
That is true.
Are they going to
and guess
think,
what?
I think at this point,
I should not.
Question quickly. All right. Please, go ahead. I know you had a quick question,
I'll
too.
Put
go
you
ahead,
down
please.
As a no vote for Trump.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there any chance the Senate's going to pick up a potential next judge?
No.
Not unless the president nominates Lisa Murkowski.
Nice. That's a good one.
No.
And what is the risk?
Mark Kirk.
I think it may be one issue in some places. It's not going to be what's going to cost the Senate. I think at the end of the day, Mitch McConnell will lose his job if he brings it up, and Chuck Grassley will probably get defeated. They're just not going to do it. It's just not going to happen. I thought the president had one shot at it if he wanted to do it, if he wanted to put Joe Biden on the court. He might have, because of Joe Biden's friendships, if he had done that early on, he might have been able to get away with it. But I think at this point in time, it's dug in deep. It's not going to happen. I don't think it's every cycle for the last 7 or 8 presidential elections that I've been around and in. The Supreme Court is the big issue. We get three, there's going to be 3 new justices appointed. There's going to be 2 new justices appointed. We've got to stop this. We've got to stop that. Never affects the vote at the end of the day.
Barack Obama and the West Wing staff, and I know this because I take these people out for drinks, are extraordinarily happy to have this fight. They really, really, really want it. This is precisely what they needed to sort of to finish out in a way that gives them a sense of purpose and focus. And it essentially makes him relevant in the middle of the 2016 campaign.
So Eric Holder is going to be the nominee.
But Glenn, you're saying that even if they don't get to put someone on the court?
That's particularly if they don't get to. There's certain times the fight is more important than the result. There's not. My question is, and you guys can answer this because you've been in the arena. Who the hell takes Obama up on the offer to be the sacrificial lamb? You know, like, who wants to subject themselves to that kind of a thing?
Well, if it's a sitting jurist, I think. Right. The reason I picked Lisa Murkowski, and I haven't vetted her. You need to be vetted. But she basically is a pro-choice, although she doesn't admit that, woman senator who's a Republican. Now, I'd love to see the Republicans turn her down.
They turn her down in a heartbeat because she is not part of the club.
No, I agree. And that sends a message to every woman in America about what the Republicans are about. And I think this is going to be a message. If they nominate Srinivasan, who got 98 votes to nothing to get appointed, all of a sudden, Indian Americans stop giving money to the Republican Party. Not that they do much anymore because of all the anti-immigration stuff, but they tend to be conservative business-type people, not hard-right conservative, but business-type people. I mean, you're right. Glenn's right. This is a political fight that we can't lose no matter what happens.
Well, I hope that the informed civil discourse in this panel is a model for what we're going to see in Miami tonight. But to be continued. Please join me in thanking our panelists for a very important.
Thank you, honestly. Thank you very much. Love to catch up with you sometime.